Everybody got a dream. Listen to me. Everybody has a dream, but not everybody got a grind. You are where you are because of how you think. And if you were to change your thinking, you would change your world.
What's going on, world? Welcome to the Secret to Success podcast. It's your host, CJ, as always, with the hip-hop preacher, E.T., Eric Thomas, Dr. Thomas. What's going on, my brother?
What's going on, C?
Man, I can't call it, man.
Somebody got to call it.
Hey, if I had your socks, I wouldn't wear shoes, brother.
No, that's right.
Old school cat hit me with that. I was like, man, I ain't got nothing else for you, dog.
Nothing else for you on that one.
Yeah, no doubt, man. Well, we're glad to be back, man. Episode 4, man. We're trying to keep these things coming, man.
Just episode, like I said, 4.
The feedback is incredible. You guys been, you know, really on it. You know, I hear you listening to it at the gym. You driving. You know, I heard some bruh say they was doing dishes and some laundry.
Not dishes,
yeah,
to
yeah,
it.
Yeah, just with the earphones.
Dishes?
Man. Yeah, getting it in, man. So they following your example, man. They getting the housework done.
No doubt.
Very grateful that you guys are tuning in. Keep telling your friends about it. Keep putting your family on it. We're going to keep this thing growing on a weekly basis for you guys. And like I said, you guys have been phenomenal. So, man, I'm trying to think of where I wanted to start today. And when I was going through my notes, you know, just about the weekend and, you know, the things that were going on, the first thing I knew I had to talk about, you know, because it was kind of a microcosm of the things we've been talking about, is I wanted to go back to that unforced errors, right? We talked about success and we talked about unforced errors. And for the people who listened to the podcast last week, they probably know that you were actually at the Cincinnati-Pittsburgh game.
Yeah.
And I'm sitting there and, I'm watching it on TV. He doesn't ever let me go anywhere, so you know what I'm saying. He got tickets for himself.
It's levels to this.
Some
it's
kind of levels. Way I didn't get any tickets, so I was stuck to watch the game on TV with the normal folks. And but he was actually live and in person. And if you guys saw the game, it was a crazy game. And there's a few things, E, that I wanted to touch on, you know, and kind of just wrap up from the things we've been talking about. And the first one was, you know, the winners win. And we talked about it. We talked about how there's no way in the world the Lions could pull that win off that the Steelers pulled, right? It just would not happen for them because of the culture, right? And then the other thing we talked about was the unforced errors, right? And these are two key pieces to success when you talk about creating a winning culture and you talk about, you know, minimizing the unforced errors. And so you look at Pittsburgh, they have the winning culture and they were able to win, but it was Cincinnati and their unforced errors that actually gave that game away. And let me just set the stage before I let E talk about it. For those of you, because I know everybody who listens to this is not a, you know, American football fan, whatever. But what happened essentially was Pittsburgh had the ball with only a minute and some change left. Roethlisberger's hurt, so he can't even throw the ball very far. So things are looking very bleak for the Steelers, right? It's looking like they're going to lose the game. And they get a couple passes, completions, or whatever. But one of the guys on Cincinnati illegally hits the Pittsburgh guy, Antonio Brown. He hits him illegally, helmet to helmet, whatever it was, hit above the head, and they give Pittsburgh a free 15 yards. Another guy on Cincinnati's team is so outraged by the call that he reacts in a way that he shouldn't have reacted, and they give him another 15 yards and push him right into field goal. So you're talking about 30 yards at the end of the game that they just gave the Steelers. The Steelers kick a field goal and win. And you look at Cincinnati and go, wow, there's the difference between a winning culture and a losing culture. One team stuck with it. They just kept battling. They put their head down. They went after it. And the other team had those unforced errors. They should be moving on to the second round of the playoffs, getting ready to play to go to a Super Bowl. And instead, they're sitting at home because of unforced errors. And E, I just thought it was so crazy that we talked about that winning culture. We talked about the unforced errors. And bam, you know, the first game that I watched of the weekend, exactly all the things that we talked about, you know, kind of come to a culmination. So you were on the field, of course, you were in, you know, with the Steelers. Just talk about what you saw and talk about, you know, kind of how that relates to what we've been talking about.
Well, you know, here's the crazy thing. So you watch that game and field goal. Then the next day you watch a game. And again, I know people are sensitive. You know, we're not talking about anybody's team specifically, but then the Vikings have, you know, a little chip, a 29-yarder to win and go to the next level, you know, and they end up losing, you know, to Seattle, you know. And I'm like, weren't they just in the Super Bowl like 2 years in a row? You know, so it's just unbelievable to see that what we keep saying, winners win. Winners win, man.
Winners win, bro.
And winners win. And winners find a way to win. You know, and unfortunately, when you are part of a losing culture, losers find a way, you know, to give it up, to give the game up, to throw it away. You know, so you're absolutely right. And I think what was unbelievable, you know, being in Cincinnati, being at the game, what really blew my mind was the fact that, you know, here it is. Pittsburgh has a backup quarterback. You know, he throws an interception, game over. Next thing you know, Cincinnati fumbles. And Big Ben comes back in the game. I think later on, it's if I'm not mistaken, I read something where it said he had a torn ligament. You know, so I'm thinking.
Yeah, I think it was something. No, I don't think it was torn, but he definitely had a stress injury on his shoulder. But he was hurting for sure. But I know it wasn't torn because they say he probably going to play this weekend. So I'm
unbelievable.
Assuming it wasn't torn. But he definitely, I mean, he left the game, right? He was out in the locker room and came back on the field and still didn't play. And in that very last series,
he had to.
Like, man.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? He had to. Yeah, so you get a guy in who's won a Super Bowl. He's being coached. The whole time you see him and coach talking, he's being coached Tomlin, who won a Super Bowl. You know, these guys have won together, and they go out and say, hey, let's make it happen. You know, and so they're believing that they can make this thing work. And so what it shows me is that, man, when you believe that you're a champion, you know, when you believe that it's never say die, when you believe that you can win, he does everything he's supposed to do. And even though you're absolutely right, there are those who are saying E.T., but Cincinnati gave him the game. You're right, but he had to throw the pass that caused, you understand what I'm saying? See, the illegal hit. He had to throw that pass. If he didn't get that pass thrown to Antonio Brown, if he didn't pass the ball to him, it would have just been down, you know, by downs. That's it. It's like possession over with by down. But he threw the ball in such a way that they had to defend it, that allowed them to get the penalty, which allowed them to get upset, which allowed Pat, man, I'm just saying, look at the string of events. It's like when you're a winner, things just happen for you. You know, the ball is tipped the right way. You know, the wind is blowing in the direction it's supposed to blow in. You know, the pass goes where the pass is supposed to go. You know, I'm looking at Alabama. You know, the last touchdown, he gets stopped on to the left. I mean, he stopped, see? He stopped. He barely turns to his right. And you talk about inches. Like that, you could have easily said that wasn't a touchdown. It was so close. You know, and so boom, scores. And Alabama, 16 championships. They find a way to winners,
yeah,
find a way to win.
So four out of seven years. Unbelievable.
Right, 4 out of 7. So here's the thing though, that's spooky, see. People probably thinking I'm watching the game and I'm jumping up and down. You know, I'm excited because I'm with Pittsburgh. You know, see, I'm going to be honest with you, man. A part of me, my heart sunk for the underdogs. Mm-hmm. You know, because I was thinking, how many good people are losing? Losers lose. How many good people are losing? See, how many good people are coming up short? How many people are losing in life because they've been on the side of losing for so long? They, you know, they've been on the negative side for so long that it appears that it's just that pattern, that cycle. So I'm looking at the game like, wow, it's man, we have to teach. And I know that's what we're going to do this year at our conferences. You know, we're going to give some tools on how to overcome losing and create a winning culture. But I'll be honest with you. See, I'm thinking my father dropped out. My grandfather dropped out. I dropped out. And had I not been very intentional and deliberate, see, it just didn't happen, man. There was some deliberate and intentional things that I had to do to put my son in a different position. And I'm looking, see, he called me today. He met with his advisor this morning, and they gave him his summer classes. And so he's going to do summer, and then that next semester, see, he's done. Wow. Like at the end of this semester, he's got 90 credits,
right?
90 credits, see? Now he's only 30 out. After this semester, he's only 30 out, see?
You know how long it took me to get 90 credits this
day? Oh, man, see? But to his, yeah, but to his, you know, credit, he had me, you, He had people who had been there, done that.
And we talked about that before, creating the winning culture.
Absolutely.
Because we went there, and I'll be honest, you know, I went through a lot of struggles being, you know, the first one in my family to go to college. I had no idea what I was doing. It was probably not until my second semester, sophomore year, that I even kind of figured out what was going on. But you talked about it. Once I figured it out, we were then able to go and pass that information along to Jalen, who's been able to sail so smooth through the process. You know, because he's had that information that we didn't have, and he got the information from the right people, right? And so that's one of the things we talk about with the winning culture. And I said this on the Breathe You the other call, and I'll repeat the story. But E and I, when we had went to Australia, of course, you know, this was our third tour. And the first two tours were crazy. I mean, like, we, you know, we had a great time, everything. But when we got back, you're talking about a 16-hour time difference.
Man.
I'm talking about jet lag. Like, especially the second time. I don't know what happened, but I was like going to sleep during the day, and I wake up at like midnight, and it was like killing me. My wife was frustrated because she like, what's going on? You sleep all day. And I'm like, boo, I'm trying to get back on this schedule, but I promise you, my body just would not do it. And I couldn't figure it out, and I couldn't figure it out. And I remember I had asked a few people, you know, how do I beat this jet lag? And they were like, you know, well, you want to make sure you stretch a lot. And then somebody else told me, just go to sleep as long as you can. And then when you get back, you'll be good. And I got all these strategies that I tried the first and second time to beat the jet lag, and it didn't work. Right. And so the last time, E, we were getting on the plane, and you didn't even know I was about to do it. But spontaneously, E and I are sitting there, and I asked the stewardess, I said, can she come? I said, can you come over here when you get a second? E was like, what you doing? And I was like, look, I figure, why not ask somebody who's an expert, somebody who does it on a regular basis, somebody who's been there, done that. And I asked her, I said, you know, we got a matter of fact, because we had Jamal's wedding, E, and Jamal had asked me, you know, of course, E was officiating the wedding. He was the pastor for the wedding, and I was hosting the reception. And so both of us needed to be fresh because it was like the day we got back. So we couldn't afford to be jet lagged, you know, at 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, you know, at night, and just be in there, you know, about to fall out. And so we asked the lady, I said, how do we beat the jet lag? And she was like, well, have you ever tried? Is this your first time flying? I said, no, this is, you know, my third trip overseas going this far. And she said, well, the good thing is, you know, I'll let you know, I do this all the time, and I actually live in the States. And so when I get back, I can't afford to be jet lagged for a week. So there's some very practical strategies that I use to defeat the jet lag. So she said, the very first thing I'm going to need you to do is, both of you guys, I'm going to bring you a bottle of water on the hour every hour.
Yeah.
And I need you to drink as much water as possible.
I remember that,
and I promise you, E, how many times do we get up and use the bathroom?
Oh,
like,
man,
20.
See.
I'm talking about, like, she was like, you need to drink as much water as possible. And she
I wanted to post up next to the bathroom and see how you use it
for
so
real.
Much.
I know people on the plane was looking at us like, yo, what are they doing in there? Like, it looked fishy. You know what I'm saying? I didn't even want to, you know, I hate to say it, but it was looking fishy. And she told us, like, I'm going to keep bringing you this water. She said, the second thing I need you to do is, the mistake most people make is they try to watch movies and go to sleep on the first part of the flight. And then they wake up and they're up until they get to L.A. She said, what I want you to do is, she was like, I want you to stay up is, or yeah, she was like, I want you to go to sleep now, take a nap for a couple of hours, and then get up halfway through. And she was like, you know, stretch your body, stretch your legs, and then only go to sleep on the last couple hours, right? She was like, you don't want to sleep too long. So I'm like, all right, cool. And then she said at the end, you remember, she said, about 30 minutes before we land, I'm gonna bring y'all this tea. I want you to drink this tea. And she says, it's gonna be hard because you're gonna be so hydrated, you're not gonna want to drink it, but I need you to drink this tea and you'll be fine. And E, I promise you,
everything,
bruh,
I
we
love
not. Did we not have
everything I love?
I never felt a piece of jet lag. I felt better getting off the plane than I felt getting on the plane, guys.
Everything.
And why am I telling
love.
You this story? I'm telling you this story because I finally got the information from the right people, right? And so there's those of you in your business right now, you know, in your, you know, your marriage, you're getting the information from the wrong people. What we're talking about with Jalen and creating a winning culture was that we were able to give him the right information. We were able to tell him what classes to take, which classes to avoid, how you were going to be strong in this area, how to navigate the campus, how to set your class schedule. It's a big campus. How to set your class schedule properly so you can make it to all your classes on time and give yourself enough breathing room here and have a lunch break here and a downtime here and not so many classes on Fridays. We were able to give him those, you know, those practical principles that he could use and then turn into a tool for his success. And in turn, we created a whole culture now of winning where Jalen is now going to graduate in 4 years,
absolutely,
a manager on the team, and has had an amazing experience at Michigan State. So for those of you out there, your business is failing and you asking the wrong people, right? Your marriage is going through it, and you ask, you talking to somebody who not married, or you talking to somebody who got divorced, right? And they don't know the practical strategies that you can utilize. When I have marriage questions, guess who I go to? I go to E. Why? He's been married 25 years, right? Me and my wife are coming up on 7 years. He's got to 25. They must be doing something right. And so therefore, I get my information from that person. And for real, to create a winning culture, we'll kind of move on from what we talked about last week. But in order to create that winning culture, you got to get the right information.
Absolutely. See, the right information, man. I was just at a detention youth center, and a young man asked me, like, yo, for real, what did you do to become successful? And I'm telling you, see, I told him, it's the people. I changed environments. And, you know, one lady was like, well, what do you do? These kids, they can't just go move to Miami. They can't move to Atlanta. They just can't move. I said, ma'am, you're not hearing what I'm telling you. I wasn't no millionaire when I made my changes. I wasn't a millionaire. So you acting like I went and moved to Dubai and changed my life. Like I moved to San Diego and bought a mansion, you know, and you know, spent all day in Beverly Hills, you know, commuted to Beverly Hills. I'm like, ma'am, when I say change environments, what I'm trying to tell you is in one environment is both good and bad. In every neighborhood, there's good and bad. I don't care what school system you go to. There's some kids in that school system that went to the best local college or went to Yale or went to Princeton or went to Harvard or went to Duke or went to, you know what I'm saying, Michigan State, whatever. Mm-hmm. There are individuals in every community. Change your environment. You don't have to move to change your environment. You just need to hang with different people. You know, so man, once I got my GED and was able to, you know, get out of Detroit, went to a Oakwood University, man, I started hanging with a different group of people. And here's what's crazy. When you get new information changes situations. So when I got that new information, see, I went to the next level. Now let me give you an example. Man, Les Brown called me yesterday. See, like, let's be real. See, how many guys are in a profession and they have the person that was the guru, the number one person in that particular arena, you know, for them, calling them. See, I didn't say I called Les Brown. I said, Les Brown called me. Like, yo, E.T., we need to, and I'm like, absolutely, let's go. Let's do it. You know, what information do you have for me? Whatever. And he's helped me change the game. Bob Pryor, these guys have helped me to change the game. And one of the things I want to bring out, see, I'm watching, well, I'm going to be honest. I didn't get to, I watched the replay. I didn't get to watch the actual game, see. My wife, can you believe it? See, we didn't even have this discussion. See, I didn't even tell you. I didn't even watch the national title, see, on Monday. I had to catch the plays on SportsCenter because my wife wanted to do a movie, a Red Box, see?
A Red Box.
It's a movie called A True Story. See, yeah, I was hurt. Hurt. Yeah, you said it, 25 years. Yeah, and I'm like, while I love, the Roll Tide and Clemson, you know, I love watching a good game, man. You know, and from what I see, it was a great game.
Great game.
You know, but you know, wifey wanted to watch the movie, and this was crazy.
Was it a football movie? At least y'all watched Remember the Titans. I hope y'all didn't have to watch The Notebook. I hope you at least got to watch The Longest Yard.
Something called A True Story, man. A True Story. See, here's what's crazy about it. She was watching a movie on a flight and didn't get to watch the whole movie. She only caught like half of it. So she was like, yo, I saw a movie that I want to watch. I'm dying laughing, see, because she telling me about this movie she wants me to go get. She don't even know the name of it, right? So she had to try to give me, I'm like, okay, give me some clues, okay? What was it about?
Wow.
I Googled it. I found it. Went up to...
So y'all had the crib playing charades trying to
figure out. Oh, man, trying to find a movie, see. But it was one of those things where she put me in a trick bag because she was like, this is all I want. I didn't get to watch the movie, and if I could just finish the movie, it should be, you know what I'm saying? She put that on me. So I'm like, okay, I got to make this happen. So I end up, man, going and find it. Of course, you know, it's a Red Box, and I'm watching a movie, see? First of all, I'll be honest with you. I had to go to like several Red Boxes to even get it. So I'm driving around.
You know,
around.
Our listeners about to clown you for still using Redbox. They got this thing called streaming where you just pop your TV on and search for the title and download it right there.
And how much is that? See, how much that cost? Because I just went with Redbox.
I think it's about
$9.
It's about 8 Redboxes a month. So you would have saved yourself.
Oh, see, you should have told me. Man, you know you should have told me because you know I don't even do movies. So that's what
I know. You still got the VHS tapes over there.
Oh, man. See,
I wanted to let you master the DVD level before I took you in the stream.
See, I could have watched the first half.
You know
half.
What I'm saying? They got Netflix now. It's something I'll put you on later.
Hey, I could have watched the first half of the movie.
Oh, you sure could.
I would have the game. So, man, so what happened is we watched that, man. Then the next day, I caught a little of the replay, man. And what blew my mind was, man, the onside kick, mm-hmm. you know. And, man, information changes situations. And a lot of people out here see thinking that there's something deep between good and great, see? Mm-hmm. There's something deep, bruh. Like, there's something... you know, information that they have that, you know, is only for a small group of people. You know, it's a secret. You know, it's in a book or it's at, you know, in some vault somewhere. See, I'm telling you, see, it's minute. It's something small. And here it is. They going Clemson, Bama going back and forth, back and forth. Everybody's scoring. Every superstar is showing up. They say that, you know, big players make big time plays in big moments. And that's exactly what they were doing. But from a coaching standpoint, it's the little small information. It was an onside kick.
It was something he saw in film that he knew they were susceptible to that.
And that changed the course. That was the one little thing that gave him the advantage.
That won him the game for sure.
Oh, man. So I'm with you, see, when you say, you know, this whole concept about, you know, being around the right people, getting the right information. And that's what I realized. Winners have that je ne sais quoi. They got that thing, see, that it factor. They know a little bit more. Not a lot, a little bit more. They move a little bit differently. They think a little bit differently. You know what I'm saying? Like, and it's not a big difference. It's that little difference that makes the biggest difference in the world.
Yeah, no, it's crazy, man. And like you said, the fact that he saw something on film, you know what I mean?
Unbelievable.
It might have been that extra hour of film study where he said, ooh, you know what, if they line up like this and we kick this onside kick, get the ball back. And he didn't know, and the crazy part is he didn't know if he was going to have to use it or not. You know, he didn't know if he was going to end up needing it.
Absolutely.
But it was just that little extra work.
And absolutely.
I agree with you 1,000%. That is for real. Think about how many times that little extra effort has made the difference for us. Right? And I tell people all the time, like, we started off with some real small wins to change the culture.
Yeah.
Right? We started off with some real small wins, them paying us out of the vending machine, you know, going to high schools, traveling, doing these small engagements. But we started with the small wins and we were able to create a momentum that sustained us, E. And that's one of the things that, for real, if people could understand, the reason that you're not blowing up is because you don't have any momentum. Right? And the losing culture, like, there is no momentum. Why? Because you're not focused on the right things. If you could just be a little better than you were yesterday, if you could just get a little bit more information, if you could just put a little bit more content out, you know, that could change everything for you. It's not always those big things that have to happen. I told you, the Steve Harvey Show, why it was a big deal for the brand and it was a good look for us, it wasn't a huge step in terms of where we were. Right? We were already knocking on that door. So it was just another step. And the inches, man, sometimes can separate you. And the inches can mean everything.
And the inches are all around us. You know what I'm saying? Now watch this. See, this is what I really need our listeners that's trying to, like, get out of that losing culture and get into a winning culture. I really need them to value the small wins, right? So most people don't know that when you want to succeed as bad as you want to breathe, let's just say it was an accident, or let's just say, see, it wasn't meant for the general population. Mm-hmm. Like, it wasn't meant for the world. It was legitimately meant for that group of students that we were talking to at an event that we do weekly and we do right. for free. Those was the wins. So doing a program listen to me, we weren't even getting paid for it. It wasn't even in the scope of our job responsibilities. It was just something that we decided to do. So every week we're being faithful over this program. Every week, We're going to this program. We are doing skits. We're doing videos. We're speaking. Like everything we do now in the world that people look at us and say, man, you guys are gurus. We were doing for free for a group of 18-year-olds. Now, it might have been a couple 19, 20-year-olds, but it was for freshmen. So you're talking about 18-year-olds, right? And it was only about 30 in attendance that day. But we're doing it every single week, every single week. So Ken just happens to come, need some B-roll. Listen to me, see, B-roll? Mm-hmm. He didn't even come to necessarily film the entire show. He just came to get B-roll, put a mic on me, put a camera, action, boom. And see, we both know that video was, I don't know where it was for years. We hadn't even done anything with it. Until finally, Chris said something about it. We put it up on YouTube for our students and our students only. And before you know it, see, at one point, the thing goes viral. So listen to me, I want to say this to you guys. Small wins. So I'm talking to one of the Advantage students the other day. He says to me, E, you know, what are you doing, bro? I said, I'm getting ready, you know, again, for the Advantage. This is 2015, see, 2015. If I'm not mistaken, it might have been the 12th, right? January 12th, I'm getting ready. And he said, E, you still doing the Advantage? E, you was just on the Steve Harvey show, E. E, you was just with the Pittsburgh Steelers. Like, you still, the Advantage? You still doing that? And I said, yo, that's bread and butter. It was that small win, those small wins that got us where we are today. So why in the world would I stop doing what got us there? Like, I do the big things when the big things present themselves, but I do the small things every day, see? I don't stop doing the small things because of the big things.
Well, yeah, that's the part most people don't want to deal with, E, because that's not glamorous. You know what I mean? Like, we're not willing to endure that. That's not the glamorous part, right? That the glamorous part is being on Steve Harvey, you know, getting thousands and thousands of views, traveling the world. But I think that's the part where most people get hung up, is nobody wants to do the grunt work. Nobody wants to go through, you know, the getting 5 views on your videos or doing an event and you got, you know, 6 people show up, 4 of them your family members. Nobody wants to go through that, but they all want to get to that level. And that's the crazy thing about it. Everybody wants to be a beast until it's time to do what beasts do. And look at what's come from that. Look at what's come from those small wins. Like, we've had so much momentum over the years, right? Like, at no point did I ever feel like we were losing. Now, we might not have been making money, you know, but I never felt like we were going backwards. It was always another step, right? It was, if one more person called, asked about the video, if one more person emailed, or, you know, we saw a couple more views, we knew we were headed in the right direction, right? We knew we were planting the seeds and eventually we'd reap the harvest. And so, no, you're absolutely right. So I agree with you 1,000%. And as it relates to the winning culture, E, you know, the other thing that I wanted to bring up that I think is so important, right? And this is, you know, on a more serious tip, because I think you were the one who, you know, brought it to me a long time ago, years ago. I was asking E about, man, you know, it's kind of tough. You know, we're doing well. I definitely see the momentum, but, you know, I kind of had a tough time believing that we'd get all the way there. And you said something to me that stuck, and I'm sure the people have heard you say it, talk about it a few times, was you say, see, we deserve it, yeah. Right? And I think some people, they don't think they deserve it. Yeah. And when I listen to you talk now, you've been on that lately, you know, even with the UOU and, you know, some of the other videos that you've been on, you've been really talking about when you made that transformation to understanding that you deserved it. You deserve to fly first class. You deserve to have your wife drive a nice car. And not even, so if you could break that down, not even the monetary things or anything of that nature, but just you deserve to have it. Like, I think that's a mindset that blocks most people from getting to where they want to get. And it stops them from creating that winning culture because they're not even sure if they deserve it, E.
Yeah, so see, like, you know, and please, this isn't for everybody, but there is a group of people, you know, that legitimately, absolute truth, that you deserve it. So here's my deal, see. I'm getting up and going to class every day, see? I'm getting up going to the tutor, see? I ain't robbing nobody. You know what I'm saying? I'm not out here talking bad about people. You know, I'm out here motivating people. I'm out here doing free work. You know, the Advantage program, see, I just left a detention center. I guarantee you, see, it wasn't more than 13 young people in that room. I didn't charge a dime. You know, I gave those kids, I put in an hour. I did question and answer. I'm getting up at 3 o'clock in the morning every year. See, day after day after day, I'm putting quotes up on, you know, Instagram, whatever. My point is, you're getting up and you grinding. You deserve it. Like, you supposed to reap what you sow. Why put in all that work? Why be a good person, you know, in heart? You know, why do good things and do good deeds and pay it forward and look out for people and take care of your family, be there for your kids? Like, why do all of that and not reap the benefits of a person who putting in that type of work? So for me, see, that's what I'm saying. Like, I deserve it, see? And I'm not saying the next man doesn't deserve it, but I deserve it, see? I deserve to stay, you know, in a nice hotel every so. I deserve to take a trip. You working 9 to 5 every day. Don't you think you deserve to take a trip? Don't you think you deserve to drive a reliable vehicle, see? See, I got tired of getting on the road not knowing if the car was going to make it, see? Hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, I've had those cars that when you start them up and you drive more than 50 miles, you don't really know if that car is going to make it or not. you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm like, man, I deserve to have a decent car. See, I remember putting gas in the car and not knowing we were going out of town if we were going to actually make it. Like, we're hoping that, you know, this $70 is going to take us all the way from here to here. See, I'm like, yo, E, you deserve to have enough gas money. Like, see, I remember going grocery shopping and not knowing if I know what I needed, see, but I didn't know if I had the money to necessarily get all of my needs. You deserve to be able to go grocery shopping and not only take care of your needs, you deserve to be able to get some ice cream if you want to, you know, get some cookies if you want to. Like, you deserve it, see. So that's what I mean. I'm talking about people who putting in the work. I'm talking about people who putting in the grind. And I'm going to tell you something. See, I remember getting so frustrated with myself saying, Eric, now I'm not saying that I'm a saint by no means. But what I am saying was, I remember saying, E, you a good dude. Like, you not stealing nobody's stuff. You finding people's wallet and sending it back with the money and the charge card in it. Like, you looking to find out who it belongs to. Somebody's car is the battery's dead, see, in the winter. I'm charging their car up. I'm helping people push their car out the snow. I'm like, yo, E, bruh, you not a bad dude, man. You deserve. If anybody, you deserve. And I think that's why so many people are stuck, because at the end of the day, you don't think you deserve. I asked a kid at the youth detention. I said, bro, where you want to be 10 years from now, 20 years from now? He said, man, I want to live in Atlanta. And I want to live in a gated community, and I want a nice car. You know what he said that blew my mind? This kid is in a youth detention center. See, people are looking at this kid like a monster. You know what he said? See, the biggest thing, he said, I want to have a family. I want a wife and kids. And I looked him in his face. Wow. I looked that kid in his face. He about to go before some judge. And the next few years is going to be based on what happens in court. And I looked at little man in his face, and I said, do you think you deserve that? And he looked at me and said, paused. Yeah. I said, no. Do you really think you deserve that? Don't tell me, yeah. And he said, yes. And I said, let me ask you something. Do you think it's somebody who comes from your same neighborhood, who went to the same schools you went to, the same type of schools you went to, grew up in the same environments that you grew up. Do you think it's somebody just like you who's 10 years older than you, 20 years older than you, who lives in Atlanta, from your socioeconomic status, from your background? He says, yep, I know it is. And I said, well, if you know it is, then why not you? See, why not you? Why can't you get there? And he said, you know what, E, you right. You're right. You absolutely right. Man, I'm going to get out of here and I'm going to make better choices. And one day I'm going to be in Atlanta. I said, and do me a favor. When you're ready to go, call me, because I want to get on the plane and go with you when you go down.
Wow.
Call me when you go. I don't care if it's 5 years from now, 10 years from now. Call me. I'll sponsor your ride down. Call me and let's go together, because I want to see it. And when they got in line and started walking out, I said to him, I said, do me a huge favor. I don't care if it take you 5 years or 10 years to get to Atlanta. Don't ever forget the fact that you deserve it. Because if you forget it, you're going to be in here from the rest of your life. But if you remember that you deserve it, you're going to get out of here and you're going to actually do it. And I said, I want to be in the car with you when you go in that gated community. You don't even have to take me to your house, but let me just see you push the buttons or see the security guard open it up for you. And I'll get out and walk back to where I got to go. So I'm telling you, if you listen to me today, if you are a good person, if you out there grinding, you out there hustling, you deserve it. Don't let your baby see you doing all that work and coming up short. Because you know what's going to happen, see? They're not going to want to put in the work if mom and daddy putting in all that work and they still coming up short.
No, man, I'm still tripping on Lil Man. That's heavy, man. And, you know, man, for those of you who ever been in the correctional system, man, you look at these kids and, you know, they're kids. I think that's the thing that blew me away. I had never been until E took me. And as you telling the story about Lil Man, I'm like getting choked up just because I remember so many of the kids that were in our lives, you know, when we used to go to Maxi and, you know, make that drive and go talk to those kids. Yeah. And like I had never been, like you might see stuff on TV and you might see stuff, you know, all around, you know, on news or whatever. But when you go in there and you hear the, you know, the buzzer ring and you see them coming out of their pods and, you know, all dressed in the same stuff and you see the despair on their faces, you know, it's just, man, it's crazy to see those kids in that light. And I remember feeling so bad, like, yo, when this is over, I get to leave. Like, we would leave there and go get something to eat and then drive back home. And I remember having those kids on my spirit so tough. And as you're talking about that story, I'm just like, wow. But that's, I mean, you told them the right thing. Like, you deserve it. You absolutely deserve it. And when we believe that, right? And so I always say to people, you know, we talk about, you know, the law of attraction, right? And people say, you say it and it comes true. Well, I want to challenge that because that's not the truth. You don't say it and it comes true. You don't believe it and so it happens. Or you don't say, okay, I deserve it and it happens. I always like to tell people, like, the power of positive thinking is so important because the positive thinking guides positive actions, which produces positive results, right? So it's not just the saying it, right? We can't stand in the mirror in the morning and say, yo, I'm going to lose this weight. I'm going to get my marriage back on track. You know, I'm going to the gym. You know, I'm reading more books. That in itself is not enough. But what happens and why that is important is because if we stand up and we're counted on and we look and we say those things every day, 9 times out of 10, those are gonna guide our positive actions, right? So if I jump up every day and the first thing I'm out the bed and I'm looking in the mirror and I'm saying, yo, you're gonna lose this weight. You're gonna get these pounds off. Nothing's gonna stop you today. Let's go. 9 times out of 10, I'm gonna take that attitude and that momentum that I gained from saying that, E, and I'm gonna go to the gym. Right? And so that's the power of positive thinking. It guides those actions. It's not that you say it and somehow magically, boom, here it comes. Boom. Oh, wow. Look at me. I said that 3 days in a row and now I lost weight. But it's creating those positive actions, man, that allows us to get those results. And the same thing is true. I'm big on the inverse. If A, you know, if A plus B is, you know, C, then B plus A is C. And so I look at how people use those negative thoughts, right? So that's the power of the negative thinking. You think, oh man, you know, I don't deserve this. You know, I'll probably never have this amount of money. It's not that you say it and that's going to happen, but it's you say that and then your spirit, you know, allows you to sit around and do nothing. So if I say, man, I'm probably not going to, you know, lose this weight. I've been trying for years. It's, you know, it's too hard. Chances are you're going to sit down on the couch, you know, and eat a bag of potato chips and watch a show. And so you're right, man. The power of positive thinking, the power of getting our mental and believing that we deserve to live the kind of life we want to live. And I think, E, the important thing, you know, you talked about before is we're not talking about money, guys. This is not about money. And I think people get it confused to say, well, oh, are you trying to say happiness is driving a sweet car? You're trying to say happiness is, you know, taking trips. I got to take a trip to Maui to be happy. That's not what we're saying. We're saying that whatever your happiness is, whatever makes you happy, those things can come to fruition through the power of positive thinking, through, you know, affirmations, through believing in yourself, your relationship with God. All of those things are important to get what you believe in, to creating that winning culture. And what E just talked about, you know, you deserve it, is one of the most critical factors. The other thing, E, that I wanted to talk about as it relates to the winning culture was, like, what are you willing to endure? You know, right, it's easy for us to say, okay, I deserve it. Yep, man, you tell Lil Man, yep, you're going to do this, you're going to do that. And then say he goes next week and sees the judge, and the judge is like, you're not ready yet. I'm giving you another year and a half. you know? And then we hit those roadblocks. And like, once you hit those roadblocks, what do you do then? Like, what happens when, you know, that feeling comes? And so what do you say to people who say, yo, E, I feel you, I'm hype, I hear you, and then boom, they run up against some huge obstacle and that halts the process right there. A lot of us get stuck right there and we start back from zero.
Yeah, I just say, apparently you didn't want it. You said it. See, everybody want to be a beast until it's time to do what real beasts do. And I'm not, man, for real, I'm not asking nobody to toot my horn. You know, I'm a grown man. I don't need nobody's affirmation. So I'm not saying what I'm about to say, you know, because I'm looking for you to be like, oh, E.T., congratulations. But see, man, I'm working on my PhD when my girl got, when we found she had 7 lesions on her brain and she was diagnosed with MS. See?
Hmm.
You understand what I'm saying? Right, like, right. Yo, and I'm not trying to, I'm not trying to, again, toot my own horn, but my faith in God was so strong that, bro, I didn't bend. Like, I didn't have no bad day. You know, I didn't get in no dumps. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, yo, if anything, I got to grind harder than I've ever grind. Like, this ain't the time to buck backwards. This ain't the time to give up or give in. Like, this is the time, if my wife ever needed me to be strong, this is the time. If my son was going to college, see, my wife was diagnosed when my son was on his way to college. I let my man know, like, yo, go enjoy yourself. You are a doggone freshman in college. Like, you don't got to worry about us. My daughter, hey, it's me and you, and we going to have to help your mom out. Still got the PhD, see? We still wrote books. We still traveled the world, bro. We still did conferences. You know, I still was there for my son. I still was there for my daughter in school. You understand what I'm saying? Like, I did not let that situation break me. What it did was made me. And you know DD and I. So you know what I'm about to say is not, you know, fabricated or made up. Man, our marriage is way sweeter than it was. Way better than it was. I thought we was doing good before she got diagnosed. Like, we on a whole nother level now. She trapped, we took sour lemons and made it into Arnold Palmer. You know what I'm saying? Not even the lemonade. Right. We Arnold Palmer'd that joint out. She travels more with me now. You know what I'm saying? We start doing lunch every day together. You know what I'm saying? We, like I said, I got a movie. Bro, it's been on another level, bro. So I just say, like, for real, maybe you thought you wanted it. Maybe it sound good, it looked good. But when you got bust in the mouth, when life punched you in the face and you folded, you know what I'm saying? When my man was like, 1, 2, you on the canvas, you got knocked out by life. 1, 2, 3, and you stayed on the ground, that's because you ain't really want it. You said in your mind, like, yo, I ain't ready to take another hit like that. I might as well go ahead and stay on the ground and get my purse, right? I might as well get this money. But some of us, when we got knocked down, said, yo, bro, I promise you, you have to kill me first. You have to kill me first, right, before I not make my dreams become a reality. You have to kill me before I just lay here and give up and give in. And so that was my thing, bro. I'm like, yo, this, we got hit by it, but I promise you it will not define us. I promise you it will not break us. I promise you I'm gonna get this degree. And I hope, I'm not sure, because it was video. I'm not sure if Carl can rip the audio, but if he could rip that audio, see, I'd love for him to take a moment right now, because you hear from me a lot, you know what I'm saying? But I would love for him to hear from my wife's mouth what she said. So if that's possible, if we could play that real quick right now.
Yep, Carl, we got that queued up.
Yes, sir. Give me 1 second. I got it.
Okay. What up, what up, what up? It's your girl, Dee Dee. That's right, that's right. Let's bring her from the bottom. Thank God it's Monday. That's right, that's right. I did it. I witnessed him do it. I saw him. He did it. He did it single-handedly while his wife was sick. If he can do it, you can do it. I just want to thank you guys for coming out. It means so much to me to see you guys here. I'm so proud of you, Eric. Wow, I'm not going to cry. Don't worry. When I got sick, I thought that was going to stop you, but it didn't. you kept going, and I'm so proud of you because you kept me strong, because just watching you keep going and not stop, it made me say we can get through this and we're going to do it. So I'm so thankful for you for being there for my kids. You keep your kids comfortable. They don't want for anything. And from 1995 on through, You've been there for us. You've done it for us, and I'm so appreciative. You started from nothing, and you made nothing out of everything. I don't even know Chuck was past a queen. He treats me better than a queen, so I'm just so grateful to God for him putting you in my life and just for taking care of me and my family, even with my mother. She's single. She got sick. You stepped right in when we had to take her to the hospital. You were there. You never complained. You never complained. I work 12 hours a week. My check probably looks like Subway's. And you just make me seem so important. It's just like, Didi, everything is yours. So I'm just so grateful to God just for everything that you've done for us and everything that you will continue to do.
All right, you guys heard it. That's powerful. I mean, for those of you, for real, you heard what he said. Now, you hear him a lot. But those words came directly from his wife, and you know, just a testament to who he is as our leader, and you know, why so many of you, you know, look to him for your inspiration. It's not just him talking, you know, he's living these things. He's human just like you are, right? He goes through the same challenges as anybody else, and you know, to hear that it's amazing, man. So man, thank you for that, E.
Oh, man. I want to switch Carl for over. Capturing it.
Yeah, no doubt. Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, that's big, though. I'm saying it's the little things. See, my wife could have given that speech, and if they hadn't captured it, audio, mic, little stuff, the mic, right mic, having everything, so had they not captured it, we would have never been able to share it with the world, and it wouldn't have given you that extra perspective. So when we talk about winners win, like winners make sure the mic is there. Like, you think it's big. It's nothing big. Oh, winners make sure that the mic is there at the gala. Winners make sure that the batteries are fully charged, and if they're not, they got a second set to go with it. Winners make sure that they test the mic before Didi even get up and get it, because she might get up and say something. Like, they make sure she mic'd up, even though she's not the main speaker. Something, she might say something that might be, you hear what I'm saying? See, winners win, man, because not because of the big stuff, but because how they approach all the stuff.
Yeah, no doubt, man. Winners win, and we definitely winning with the Ask ET segment. This is one of our most requested segments of the show. Highly popular now, this being our fourth time. People always want to know what's on E's mind, what's going on. And as always, this segment is brought to you by ETA Grind Gear, redefining the grind one day at a time. Listeners to this podcast can use the promo code Secret to Success and get an extra 20% off at checkout, available exclusively at etinspires.com. Go check it out. The first question comes to us from Sean from Columbus. He wants to know, with the lottery being so high, will Mr. E.T. be buying a ticket?
Nah, bro.
It's at like $1.5 billion. I'm not going to lie. Maybe $1.2 billion. I have never bought a lottery ticket a day in my life. I was driving past the store, and I'm not going to lie, I did think about jumping out. What is it, $1, $2? I want to be in the number. You know what I'm saying? I just want to have a shot. But one point something billion, I said, okay, now that might be worth buying a ticket. But the question was asked to you, will you be buying a lottery ticket?
I know the answer, real,
but I think
see.
It's hilarious.
Yeah, I'm going to be real, man. Like, 100, see, you know, research shows, it's not E.T., Research shows see that, man, I don't know if it's 50 or 70% of the people that win all that money, most of them lose it in a matter of 5 to 6 years. See, they lose the money, and then the life, man, just...
It's one point something billion, though, this time, E. They was losing 40 million. You know what I'm saying? I don't know. You get at least 10 years to run through 1.3 billion.
See,
I need at least 10 good years.
Hey, all I'm saying is research shows that when you earn it, you treat it differently than when you win it, see? Hmm. And what we've discovered is that the life of most of the people that win that kind of money, they have a terrible life after it. There are people who get on drugs. There are people, man, who commit suicide. It just, the stories of the people who won it, the percentage of people who live happy lives after, see, it's far and few in between. I just believe, see, that we gonna get to the billions, but we gonna earn it. And when you earn something, see, you treat it differently. When you work for it, you value it differently, see?
Oh, man, who you telling? I promise you, man, back in the day when my people used to buy me stuff, sneakers, gym shoes, stuff like that, and they used to be buying it, I used to be dogging them out. I'm on the hoop court with them. I promise you, the day I got on my own and had to start buying my own stuff, oh, man, I had them joints washed, waxed, cleaned every night.
I got the toothbrush out. Wax off!
I got to make these suckers last. So, no, you right, man. You definitely treat stuff different when you have to work for
it. I mean, do the homework, see? Because it's somebody like, hey, man, come on, whatever. It's look, do your homework. Like, research it. When somebody gives you something and you don't work for it, I had a friend call me the other day, you know, and they wanted to get some money for an investment for a business. And I'm just going to be real, see? You know, when you a homie, man, you want to look out for the homies. But see, come on, man. The reason why we grind so hard, nobody gave us nothing, see? Nobody gave us nothing, see? I'm saying, even from a recognition standpoint, we've never gotten a plaque or a certificate or a trophy from some major organization. It hasn't happened. Nobody wrote us a check for $50,000 to do what we're doing. Hey, we're going to sponsor that. Thank God it's Monday. We're going to sponsor that. This is the seventh year you've done it. You done put up over 400 videos. We got your back, E. We're going to send you $1,500 to keep going. Nobody even sent us $1,500, see? But I think that's why we value this company so much, because every single part of it, we built this thing brick by brick by brick, see? Nobody gave us nothing. And I think that's where the passion, where that passion come from? Building bricks by brick, mm-hmm. Building this thing from the ground up. So when we say started from the bottom, now we here, like it's so authentic because it's real. Nobody gave us nothing. So I don't want your $40 billion, $100 billion. I don't want none of your lottery ticket. I want to earn everything I get, bruh.
Yeah, no doubt. Okay, I guess you answered it for me because I was going to stop on my way home from getting Trey and try to grab me one. But you know what I'm saying? Now you done convicted me. And I think I'll switch it up. Let's see. Jason from Jason from somewhere in Texas wants to know, what's the most embarrassing song on E.T.'s iPod?
The most embarrassing song on E.T. iPod. What do you mean by embarrassing?
I would ask him if I had a follow-up. I think he means like something that people wouldn't expect from you or something.
Probably Marvin Gaye, Sexual Healing.
Oh, yeah. Nah, hey, you know what's funny, though? I remember when E first got his iPod and he would be working out and he didn't listen to nothing but Destiny's Child Survivor.
Oh, that's like that was my song.
Hours straight. He would have his whole he'd just put it on repeat and just be running to Destiny Child Survivor for like hours. And I'm like, bro, what is you doing?
I'm a survivor. That's how I love those lyrics. They got to listen to those lyrics, see?
Yeah, no doubt, man. We got another question from a Jason who says, top five books. Jason from Twitter, Jason Muhammad said, what are your top five books, E.T.?
So I would probably have to say Think and Grow Rich, both editions, Napoleon Hill, Think and Grow Rich, A Black Choice, Dennis Kimbrough. And the reason why I love Dennis Kimbrough's version of it is just because he highlights individuals, you know, who come from my background, you know, people who have been through similar experiences as I have, you know, and been able to overcome. The Richest Man in Babylon is a phenomenal read. Definitely Who Moved My Cheese, phenomenal, small read, phenomenal read. Pilgrim's Progress is a book that changed the course of my life. And if I could just throw in two extras, The Outlier, I'm on Malcolm Gladwell, whatever, Outliers, you know, is a book that Outliers changed, you know, my life as well. And I've got to say, Ogmandino's The Greatest Salesman, you know, that ever lived. Those are top seven. You know, hey, I don't know where he was going with it. You know, the Bible to me is the, you know, supreme read, but, you know, he may not have been going there. You know, but the ones I mentioned, if he was just talking about self-help in business, those are the books that I would recommend.
Good. Samantha in Grand Rapids. I know you said to eliminate distractions, E.T., but what if your family is the distraction?
You know, I don't care what the distraction is, you can eliminate it. You know, it doesn't make a difference what it is. There are ways to curve the time you spend with your family. There's a way to, curve the negativity that's coming from them. You know, and let me say this. This may seem odd to you guys, but my wife has never, my wife has her own profession. You know, so I don't have a wife who is, you know, I'm the CEO of a company and she the COO. You know what I'm saying? It doesn't work like that. You know, my wife has her own profession. She's a registered nurse and she works with, breast and cervical cancer, and that's her thing. You know, so my wife does not want to hear 5-6 hours of me talking about my company. You know, and you'd be shocked. Everybody's thinking, oh man, E.T. But just think about it. If you have seen me on the road, like, you've never really seen my wife standing next to me giving a presentation or speaking, right? So for me, somebody would be like, man, your wife negative, man. I can't believe she's not supporting you like that. No, she's not negative, right? There are things that she wants to talk about, and we could talk about that. So what I do is I defer. So I don't get mad at my wife because she didn't want to talk about the business, because she didn't want to help me 90% of the time with the business. I take the 10-15% that she gives me. So what do I do when I need that positivity? I call C. She want to talk about the business all day. I call Carl. We talk about the business all day. Are you hearing what I'm saying? I call LaShawna or Tay. We can talk about the business all day. So that's not a distraction for me because my wife don't want to talk about the company. So when I'm with my wife, we'll talk about our family, because she could talk about our family forever. She could talk about our future forever. So it's not, I don't allow the fact that she doesn't want to talk about the company to be a distraction. So when I'm ready to do that, I talk to the staff members about it, and they can't get, man, C can't get enough. Me and C could, we could, man, go for hours building about this company. So even if it's family, there's still a way for you not to allow your family to be a distraction.
Yeah, dope, man. And the last question comes from Mark in Detroit. He says, CJ, what's one thing, from the D, man, shout out to Mark. What's one thing people don't know about E? Let me think. What's one thing? E's so transparent, man. He pretty much tell you guys everything. Is Carl there? Maybe Carl could help us. Oh, you know what? I take that back. One thing y'all probably don't know, you might have heard us mention it. E tends to be a bit forgetful. So I would say maybe the fact that, for real, E will lose everything but somehow always get it back. It's the craziest thing. Like, if you know the dude who goes out to dinner and like leaves their card at the restaurant, or drives away with his wallet on top of the car, or I mean, just misplaces anything. Like, it could be a check, it does not matter. He would lose his head if it wasn't attached to his body. That's one thing. And I think the other thing would be that he is the most generous and cheap person you ever met at the same time. And it's crazy. I told y'all maybe last week or the week before that about the $20,000 gift that he anonymously gave that I blew up on spot last week. But so $20,000 to a random person, just out of the kindness of his heart, or we'd be, you know, walking somewhere, he'd give somebody, you know, a kid just like, yo, E.T., I'm on my way to college. And we'll just stop at the ATM, give him $500. But I promise you, if you had the drive-through window and something come out to $6.02, he gonna spend about a half hour searching the car for them 2 pennies. You got 2 cents. Somebody got 2 cents. Come on, man. I ain't trying to break this dollar. Somebody get 2 cents. Ma, you got in the back seat. Anybody got 2 cents? I'm like, E, just go and give it a $7, bro, and get that 98 cent back. So no,
I don't like that heavy change in my pocket. See, heavy change ain't good for the pocket.
Yeah. So I would say E is the most generous, cheapest person you ever met in your life, man. So. Thank you guys for that. Ask E.T. is always fun, man. As always, just want to take a minute before we close out, E, and you can give the people your nugget for the day. But I want to take a minute to tell you guys what we're doing in Breathe University. Just had another amazing call. We've changed over our calls to Thursdays and Sundays now because we got the success series on Tuesday. I'm not going to belabor it. You guys know what it is, but you know, it's a $20 fee to get started with us. All kind of new audio going up every day. E just finished speaking at the detention center, just finished speaking at a corporate company. We're putting both of those speeches up, guys. So we can't put everything on YouTube. Everything can't come out, you know, on the website. So some of the stuff we do save for, especially for our Breathe University students. So he just did an amazing keynote in Detroit with a financial institution, talking to them about branding and how to build their business and how to overcome some things. Our keynote, we're putting all that stuff up, guys. And this stuff all comes with your package. You'll be able to hear this stuff, be able to jump on the calls with us, build the community, help us take Breathe University to a whole nother level. We've got some amazing students from all over the world, resources, they're connecting. You guys come out to events, you get the VIP treatment when our conference comes to your area. Well worth the investment of $20, the price of a haircut, the price of, you know, an expensive sandwich per month, man. You could be, you know, a part of the squad and see what we got going on. So breatheuniversity.com, go check us out. If you like what we're doing on the podcast, you like what we're doing with the videos, I promise you it's a whole nother level, E. And I think they'll be excited to join, and we look forward to having them as a part of the family.
Yeah, no doubt, C. So, all right, so the nugget for the day, I would say never stop believing in hope, C, because miracles happen every single day. So I just I want to say it again, and I want to say it in a way that you understand it, that out everywhere, man, all over the world, miracles are happening. I mean, big things. Somebody's going to win that lottery, like for real. Somebody's going to win that eventually, right? So positive stuff. Somebody's getting a college tuition paid for. You know, somebody, needed a transplant, and, you know, something happened where they were able to get a heart transplant or whatever. Like somebody today, something big is about to happen to somebody. They're about to get that big time job they've always wanted. Look, miracles are happening every day, but they only happen to those that still believe, and those who still have hope, those who still have faith. So I just want to say, if you don't have faith, if you don't have hope, like if you're a negative person and you're not a believer, then you have just cut yourself off of all the miracles that could possibly happen. But once you believe, once you have faith, man, you put yourself in a position for any and everything positive to happen in your life.
You heard it here first, guys. Thank you for listening. Thank you for tuning in. We'll be back next week with another edition of the Secrets of Success podcast. Y'all go out and do what you got to do, man. Be phenomenal and be forgotten. We'll talk to you later.
You make this, you concentrate on this opportunity. You don't worry about tomorrow. You concentrate on this opportunity.